Okay, so welcome to the last session of the theory day. The first talk will be by Michael Elkin. Michael is currently a professor at the CS department in the Ben-Gurion University. He finished PhD in 2002 in the Weizmann Institute, and then was a postdoc in Princeton and in Yale. His research concerns panels, distributed algorithms, additive number theory, and distributed symmetry breaking problems, which is the topic of your talk today. Okay.
Okay, thank you for the kind introduction, and thank you to the organizers. I'm pleased to be here, honored. The topic of my talk is indeed distributed graph coloring problems, symmetry breaking in general. It will be based on a series of papers joined with Leonid Barenboim and another more recent paper joined with Leonid Barenboim, Petty and Schneider. Oh, sorry, many things cannot be seen here, but imagine a graph right here. And this graph...
This is an
empty graph. But imagine a non-empty graph with some edges in it, not just vertices. And all vertices of it will host processors which are trying to compute something in parallel by communicating over the edges of this graph. So the edges really need to be there, otherwise they cannot communicate. And the communication is synchronous, it occurs in discrete rounds. What we measure is the number of rounds of discrete communication. So the local computation comes for free, and all vertices are assumed to wake up simultaneously. They have unique identity numbers between one and the number of vertices in the graph. So we do all plausible assumptions that make life easier in this model, the simplest model that can be imagined. The model is called local model, the name coined by David Pelage, I think, but the idea was introduced in Linear's paper. It abstracts away everything else but the communication. And I will need some notation. So by delta, we will denote the maximum degree of a vertex in the graph. A k-vertex coloring is a legal k-vertex coloring. It's a coloring in which no edge is monochromatic. Edge coloring is legal if no two incident edges get the same color. And in distributed setting, we typically want something trivial, like delta plus one coloring, or vertex coloring, or two delta minus one edge coloring, because we want something that can be easily done in centralized model, and we want to see how efficiently can it be parallelized, made distributed. And there are a couple of more symmetry breaking problems of this kind. Maximal independent set is probably the most famous of them. Here we want an independent set, meaning no pair of vertices share an edge between them, and it's maximal under containment, not cardinality maximal. So for any vertex not in the set, there is a vertex in the set. And maximal matching is analogous one, so it's a set of disjoint edges, a matching, and maximal under containment again, not cardinality maximal. And all these problems are, of course, trivially solvable in order n centralized steps. Say delta plus one coloring, we color vertex by vertex each time we have an available color, because the palette is of size delta plus one, while there are at most delta forbidden colors at every point in time. The same for maximal independence, we pick a vertex, remove its neighborhood, and keep on doing it. One useful observation is that all these problems reduce actually to maximal independent set. So maximal independent set is a kind of hardest out of this family. We don't know if it's strictly hardest or just one of the hardest, but they all reduce to MIS. Two delta minus one edge coloring reduces to delta plus one vertex coloring through line graph. Maximal matching reduces to maximal independent set through line graph again. And delta plus one vertex coloring reduces to MIS. This is not trivial, it's Lubis reduction, something I won't be showing today, but it's a fact useful to know. Okay, so an elementary color reduction technique, basic, one of the basic instruments in this methods in this along these lines, is that if we are given an alpha coloring for some alpha greater than delta plus one, we can always reduce the number of colors one at a time. Say we pick all vertices of color alpha, they form an independent set, so they can recolor themselves into one of the colors from the palette 1, 2 up to delta plus 1 in parallel. And therefore in alpha minus delta plus 1 rounds we can get delta plus 1 coloring. We start from an alpha coloring for any alpha. A very simple but useful idea. And a more advanced, more sophisticated color reduction technique, we call it color reduction because it reduces the number of colors, not the reduction in the sense of reduction between problems. Another color reduction technique is due to Kuhn and Wettenhofer. So here we assume that alpha is some integer multiple of delta plus one for simplicity. And just for this talk, it works for any value of alpha. And also assume that C is a large, is an integer power of 2, again for simplicity. So then we partition the vertex set into subsets U1, U2, etc. up to U sub C, where U1 is the vertices of colors 1, 2 up to delta plus 1. U2 is the vertices of colors delta plus 2, delta plus 3 up to 2 delta plus 2, etc., etc. Right, we start with some original alpha coloring and partition the vertex set in this way. And then we pair subgraphs. We pair U1 with U2, U3 with U4, etc., etc. And if we consider one single pair now, U1 union U2, then this pair is 2 delta plus 2 colored. So we can reduce the number of colors just within this graph, just within U1 union U2. Into delta plus 1 coloring in just delta plus 1 rounds because we have 2 delta plus 2 colors by previous idea. And in parallel we can do that in U3 union U4 and in parallel in U5 union U6, etc. So we have the number of colors in just one phase that lasts for delta plus 1 rounds. And now we keep halving it and in all together log alpha over delta plus 1 rounds, we will, faces, log alpha over delta plus 1 faces, each lasting for delta plus 1 rounds, we will get a delta plus 1 coloring. So all together in order delta log alpha over delta time, we get delta plus 1 coloring. And there is a result by Natty Linea that order delta square coloring can be achieved in log star n time. If we apply this result together with this technique, first compute this order delta square coloring through Linear's algorithm and then apply Kuhn-Wettenhofer's color reduction, we get order delta log delta plus log star n time for delta plus 1 coloring. And this was a state of the art until recently for delta plus 1 coloring problem. This bound of order delta log delta plus log star n. Now the log star n is for a reason there. There is a lower bound that one cannot get below log star n. People looked for a reason for this dependence of delta log delta, and the one that they could come up with is that for a certain class of algorithms it cannot be improved. The specific class is what's called locally iterative delta plus one coloring algorithms. These are the algorithms in which on every round the vertex looks on its neighborhood, on the colors of its neighbors, and deduces by some function out of this colors of the neighbors, it's new color, and then repeats it round after round. So the Zagedi and Viswanathan showed that for such algorithms, locally iterative ones, one cannot break the order delta log delta bound. And recently we have shown, I will talk about it more later, that by using other algorithms one can do better, but unfortunately we don't know much better results than then, even by these new other techniques. Okay, so other known classic results, classic and not classic. So for randomized coloring, delta plus one coloring and MIS and maximum matching, and all these problems can be solved in distributed logarithmic time. This is known from mid-80s. More recently, Kasapali, Scheidel, Ronalds, and Schindelhauer showed that for order delta coloring, if one relaxes the requirement on the number of colors, then one can do significantly better and do it in order square with log n randomized time by randomized algorithm. More results that were known before our work is of Schneider and Wettenhofer, the deep delta plus one coloring in order log delta plus square root log n time, which is better than log n whenever log delta is better than log n. It's never worse, but it's often better. And more results allowing more colors, you can get it even faster, you can have running time even smaller. Now, our recent randomized results for maximal matching, let's start with delta plus one coloring. Here we can have log delta plus exponential and square root log log n, rather than just square root log n in previous result. And for maximal matching, we have here order log delta plus log log n to the power of 4. And maybe most importantly, is this last one, is for MIS order log square delta plus exponential and order square root log log n. So this result is kind of the first which behaves better than log n for a wide family of graphs for a wide range of deltas, but unfortunately not for the entire family, so it doesn't scale up well when delta becomes greater than 2 to the square root log n. But up to that threshold we do get improved bounds even for the hardest problem, which is MIS, hardest in this family. And the basic approach here, yeah, it's too bad that nothing can be seen. So the basic approach here is that we do order log delta, roughly speaking, order log delta Luby steps. By Luby step I mean that there is a famous algorithm of Luby in which at every step, every vertex tosses coins by certain rules. I don't want to get into details of how it does it. But as a result of this tossing coins, some vertices join MIS, some vertices decide that they will never join MIS, they are incident adjacent to some MIS vertex, and some other vertices don't decide, stay undecided. These other vertices continue to another Luby step. And what we can show, roughly speaking, is that after order log delta Luby steps, the graph decomposes into disconnected components. So here I had some C1, C3, C2. Each disconnected component of those has small size. Disconnected components of just size polylogarithmic in n. And then in these disconnected components we can invoke the state-of-the-art deterministic algorithm for the problem. We cannot recurse in these components, unfortunately, because the components are of size at most poly log n, and so the error probability if we run a randomized algorithm within each component will be at most 1 over poly log n, which is too large. So we cannot use a randomized subroutine within each of these components, so we use a deterministic one. And say for the MIS, there is an algorithm that for a graph with S vertices, deterministically computes an MIS in time exponential in order square root log s. This is a result by Pankanesi and Srinivasan. So we run it on each component in parallel, and our additional time will be exponential in order square root log log n, because s is at most polylogarithmic in n. This is the basic approach. So we do log delta Luby steps that decompose, break the graph into small components, and run a deterministic state of the art algorithm on each component. And thus our total time is order log delta plus this term. For maximal matching there is a better deterministic algorithm that takes just log to the 4 s time, and so the second step will take order log to the 4 log n time rather than exponential and log log n. So there is an interesting phenomenon here that improved deterministic algorithms give rise to improved randomized ones. This gives some motivation to explore deterministic algorithms, even though I believe that they are of interest of their own sake, but this is yet another motivation to explore them. And comparing this to lower bounds to give some idea of how far away this from lower bounds. So the short answer is that it's very far away from the lower bounds. And the basic lower bounds is that of linear that f delta coloring for any function of f requires at least half log star n time. And as I mentioned, for passes and cycles it is tight. There is a half log star n time plus order one, half log star n plus order one algorithm for solving these problems on these specific creatures on passes and cycles. But on general graphs, the best known current upper bound is order log delta plus exponential and square root log n. So the dependence on n here is much worse than the lower bound, and the dependence on delta, there is just no lower bound, so it's completely a huge gap, a great open problem to work on, I think. I will skip the second comparison there, because the gap there is not that large. Another important lower bound is of Kunmus, Hebroda and Utenhofer, much more recent. They show that maximal independent set and maximal matching require minimum of these two expressions, omega log delta, minimum between log delta and square root log n time. Now, our upper bound for maximal matching is log delta plus log n to the power of 4. So this is tight for log delta in this range between log n to the power of 4 and square root log n, tied up to constant factors, but it is not tied for delta greater than exponential and square root log n. There the upper bound will be just log delta and the lower bound is square root log n. There is a significant gap there, and the gap is even greater when we consider the maximal independent set problem, because here our upper bound is worse, it's just order log square delta plus exponential and order square root log n. Turning to deterministic results, there is an algorithm of Goldberg, Plotkin and Shannon from 80s showing that delta plus one coloring can be computed in order delta square plus log star n time. Linear strengthens that, I mentioned this result, by showing order delta square coloring in log star n time. And he asked, deterministically, and he asked whether one can get much fewer than delta square colors in by deterministic algorithm in time polylogarithmic in n. And this was open up until recently. We gave an affirmative answer to this question. I will show it in the next transparency. Another result that I already mentioned also is for MIS, exponential and square root log n time for deterministic MIS, and therefore deterministic other problems like delta plus one coloring, edge coloring, etc., maximal matching. For maximal matching, interestingly, there is also a result in deterministic algorithm in log to the 4 n time. So this is kind of an exception. All other distributed symmetry breaking problems, there is no known deterministic polylog time algorithm for them. But for maximal matching, there is one. I don't know whether this exception is a real exception, or we just don't know to give such an algorithm for MIS or other problems. Okay, so some new deterministic results. One result is for delta plus one coloring, order delta plus log star n time. It's a result with Barenboim and independently by Kuhn. This improves the previous bound of order delta log delta, which I outlined in the beginning of the talk. And it breaks the Segedi-Vishwanathan's barrier, which applies for locally iterative algorithms. This algorithm is naturally not locally iterative. And again, there is a major open problem, the gap between the lower bound of half log star n and the upper bound of order delta plus half log star n. So the dependence on delta is completely open. It might be square root delta, log, or may not be there at all. It's a major gap. Now we also could show that delta to one plus eta coloring can be done in order log delta log n time for any arbitrarily small eta greater than zero. This answers Linear's question, this first bullet here. this first bullet here answers Linian's question, because he asked whether one can do less than delta square coloring in deterministic polylogarithmic time, and this is a deterministic polylog time, at most log square n time, algorithm for delta to 1 plus eta coloring. But we don't know, say, to get order delta coloring or delta multiplied by polylog delta. It's still open whether this can be done in deterministic polylogarithmic time. And we have better results for edge coloring, but I will skip them. Okay. So there are also some specific families of graphs on which people got better results. My favorite one is the family of graphs with bounded arboricity. There are also some others. It has roots in the work of Goldberg, Plotkin, and Shannon on planar graphs. They showed that on planar graphs all these problems can be solved in deterministic logarithmic time. We extended it and improved to graphs of bounded arboricity. So arboricity can be viewed as the density of a graph. We take a set of vertices u and divide the number of edges induced by this set by the number of vertices, roughly speaking, and take maximum over all sets. This is the arboricity, and forests have arboricity 1, planar graphs have arboricity at most 3. And this is a rich family of graphs. It includes, say, all graphs that exclude any fixed minor. There is a Nash-Williams theorem saying that a graph of arboricity A can be covered by A edge disjoint forests. Another important view of this notion of arboricity is degeneracy. Degeneracy and arboricity are, for the sake of this talk, exactly the same thing. In fact, they differ by a factor of 2, at most by a factor of 2. And degeneracy is the minimum number d such that we can order vertices of the graph v1, v2 up to vn, so that each vi will have at most d neighbors vj with a great index. Right, so it may have a lot of neighbors to the right of it, but it will have at most d neighbors to the left of it. And what's good about having small degeneracy is that it can be colored. What's good in this context, at least. Because we can start with coloring Vn in an arbitrary color, and when we are coming to color Vi, it has at most d colored neighbors, so given a palette of size d plus 1, we can color it. So there is, so this suggests that it's good to work with this family in the context of coloring. And what we can show is that order degeneracy, order arboricity coloring can be achieved in order a log n deterministic time, and a bunch of other results along this line, such that order qa square coloring in order log n over q time. This was improved by Kosopali and Pomaradze and set and range of this parameter q to order qa coloring in order log n over log q randomized time. So this is tight, this trade-off is tight between the number of colors and the stretch, number of colors and time, but it is not known to apply to the entire range of parameters, and it is only randomized and not deterministic, so there are some open problems along these lines. And what we also could show is that MIS and delta plus 1 coloring can be solved in order log n over log log n time. And also all other problems, these symmetry breaking problems, can be solved in order log n over log log n times as long as arboricity is small, say constant. And if arboricity is at most polylogarithmic in n, then all these problems can be solved in deterministic polylogarithmic time. So this expression log n over log n, we don't know whether it's in place there or it's just an artifact of our result. It improves the previous results of Goldberg, Plotkin, and Shannon from log n to log n over log n, but it's not clear how tight is this. And in fact, we know better randomized algorithms for these problems. Again, it's not clear what does that mean, because it's not clear that randomized results can be matched by deterministic algorithms, Maybe there is lower bounds separating these two, but we don't know such lower bounds yet. And also, one can get a to the 1 plus eta coloring, so allowing more colors than degeneracy colors. Degeneracy to the power of 1 plus eta for some small eta greater than 0 can be done in just log a log n 10. And this implies, because arboricity of degeneracy is always smaller than the degree, it implies delta to 1 plus eta coloring in order log delta log n time, which is the result I've already mentioned, the result answering linear Solkin question. But it also means that if arboricity is at most delta to 1 minus epsilon, we can get delta plus 1 coloring in deterministic polylogarithmic time. So the only family of graphs in which we don't know delta plus 1 coloring in deterministic polylogarithmic time is when arboricity is very close to delta. This is the hardest case somehow of this problem. And indeed, it's harder to color because the graph is dense, so you have less choices to make. And for we also have so we can also show randomized bounds for maximum matching log of degeneracy plus square root log n, and it matches the lower bound of square root log n, at least when arboricity is quite small, up to 2 to the square root log n. And for MIS, again, we get log square arboricity plus log to the 2 over 3 n. This looks as an artifact, it should be square root log n. But interestingly, for MIS, we don't know a lower bound for graphs of arboricity 1. For maximum matching, we know a lower bound. Even for trees, you want to compute a maximum matching on a tree, you need at least square root log n time, and we have an algorithm that does it in square root log n time. Interestingly, for MIS, there is an algorithm that does it in order square root log n roughly time up to log log n, but there is no lower bound for some reason. There is a technical difficulty there, or maybe not technical. Okay, so now I will give up some intuition of how to work with graphs with bounded arboricity. So in graphs of degeneracy at most d, there is always a vertex with degree at most d. But what's good about them is also that there is a constant fraction of vertices with degree at most 3d. Or for any constant greater than 2, there is a constant fraction of vertices with degree at most this constant multiplied by a, by the degeneracy. So we can always remove an entire set of vertices, we call it a set H, and stay with a graph with the same degeneracy, with at most the same degeneracy, maybe smaller, and repeat this argument. Keep peeling the graph up until we are left with an empty graph. So we will get sets H1, H2, etc. up to HL, where L is log n, and it will have the property that on the left there is some set with vertices of degree at most capital A. Here we have some set with vertices of degree at most capital A with respect to the residual graph, etc., etc. So it will always have the property that a vertex in a set here will have at most capital A, where capital A, sorry, is a constant multiplied by the degeneracy, where so every vertex here will have at most capital A neighbors in the sets H with the index of this vertex and greater indices HI, HI plus 1, etc. up to the end of it. And this decomposition can be computed in just log n time. And given this decomposition, we can quite easily color the graph. And the way to color the graph is the following one. We color separately each set HI. Each set HI has maximum degree at most capital A, at most constant multiplied by the degeneracy, by the arboricity. And A plus 1 coloring can be done in order A plus log star n time. It's something I'm using here without a proof. And so each HI, we have a coloring phi I that uses A plus 1 colors for it. And then we recolor the entire graph to obtain a unified A plus 1 coloring for the entire graph. And on this step, we will spend order A multiplied by the number of sets by log n time. and I will show how. So we will spend a plus one rounds in each set HL. So we start with the set HL, and in which is the last set in the sequence. We have H1, the set we removed first, then H2, the set we removed second, up to the set HL, which we removed last, which are the vertices of the grid, most capital A, at the end, at that stage when all vertices have the grid, most capital A. And now the vertices in the set HL just retain their color. For vertices of HL minus 1, this is the set HL minus 1, we look on the color classes of this vertex set. There is a color class 1, color class 2, up to color class capital A plus 1. This vertex set, vertices of color class 1 within HL minus 1, can recolor themselves in parallel. So it's again the same idea. They have at most capital A neighbors in HL, so they can select for themselves colors from the palette 1, 2 up to capital A plus 1. Then vertices of color 2 within HL minus 1 can again recolor themselves in parallel because they form an independent set and each of them has at most capital A neighbors in the union of HL minus 1 and HL. So they again recolor themselves in parallel, and all together in capital A plus 1 rounds we recolor the entire set HL minus 1, and then we proceed recoloring the entire set HL minus 2, etc. up to H1, all together in order A log n rounds, we will be done recoloring the entire vertex set of the graph. So we will get the result of it, order A coloring in order A log n time. And so this is the basic result, but to get better than that, we need actually two major building blocks, which I will just sketch, talk about which very shortly. The first one is the idea of defective coloring. The idea of defective coloring, I will probably give first the definition of defective coloring and then return to that slide. Given a coloring phi, not necessarily legal, the defect of this coloring is the defect of this coloring in a given vertex is the number of neighbors it has with the same color. And the defect of the entire coloring is the maximum over all vertices of defects of different vertices. So if a coloring has small defect, it means that every color class induces a small degree graph. And this is very useful because our coloring algorithms, not only our, but previous also, the running time is proportional to the degree of these subgraphs. So if we can partition the graph into vertex sets of small degree, we then run in parallel our coloring algorithm in each color class and get a coloring. Then we merge colorings in some trivial way. So this is the idea of using defective coloring. The other idea, arc defective coloring, is actually very natural, given the defective coloring and the idea of arboricity, is partitioning the graph into vertex sets of small arboricity, rather than of small degree of small arboricity. Again, we have algorithms that run in time proportional to the arboricity, to degeneracy. So we partition the graph into these vertex sets, color each in parallel, get a unified coloring for the entire graph in time smaller than proportional to the original arboricity. So these are the two building blocks, defective coloring and dark defective coloring. And given some more details about this, the notion of defective coloring was introduced in mid-80s by a bunch of authors. Lenor Cohen is one of them, Jacobson, Frank Harari. But in fact, Lovas proved something about it 20 years before it was introduced. So it was implicit in Lovas' work that for any p, there exists a delta over p defective p coloring of a graph. The product here is delta. I will give a proof of this result, and that will probably be the last technical thing I will do, then I will turn to open questions. So the proof is as follows, very nice proof, due to Lovas. So we start with some arbitrary p coloring. Suppose it's not delta over p defective, otherwise we finished. Then there is a vertex of defect at most delta over p. Then there is a vertex of defect greater than delta over p. But then by pigeonhole principle, there is a color such that at most delta over p of neighbors of V are colored by this color. Recolor V in this color, etc. And return it. And repeat it time after time up until you will get delta over p defective coloring. The argument showing that it will actually give you eventually defective coloring, delta over p defective p coloring, is the following one. Let ME stand for monochromatic edges, ME sub I, the number of monochromatic edges before iteration I starts. Now, let V be the vertex recolored on the ith iteration. So ME sub I plus 1, the number of monochromatic edges after I iteration, is the number of monochromatic edges before the iteration starts, minus the defect of V, because all vertices that were monochromatic before this iteration stopped being monochromatic, plus at most delta over P, because at most delta over P new edges became monochromatic. We chose the color such that at most delta over P neighbors of V have it. So this is strictly smaller than ME sub I. But in this number of monochromatic edges is at most the cardinality of the edge set, and it's certainly not negative. So in a finite number of steps, we will end up with a monochromatic, we will end up with a defective coloring, with delta over p defective p coloring. Unfortunately, there is no known distributed counterpart of Lovo's theorem, but what we can show is delta over p defective order p square coloring, slack of p here, and Kuhn also proved a similar bound with a better running time. So it's open whether one can achieve a linear product of defect and number of colors. We have some partial answers to that. For edge coloring, it's true, one can get a linear product, and this gives rise to improved edge coloring algorithms, but not for vertex coloring, not known for vertex coloring. Okay, I will skip this entire part, which shows in more details how one can use defective colorings to do legal colorings. And some open questions. So, most prominent one is whether delta plus one coloring or MIS can be computed in deterministic polylogarithmic time. Whether delta to 2 minus epsilon coloring can be computed in sublogarithmic time. Linear came up with delta square in log starren time. Ideally, it would be delta to 2 minus 1 in log starren, but even sublogarithmic is something I will buy. And the question I discussed about delta plus 1 coloring. This is the question I just mentioned about distributed counterpart of delta of Lovo's theorem. I will skip the next one. Maximal independent set or maximal matching can randomize small O of log n time for all values of delta. We could get it only when delta is at most, say, log delta strictly smaller than log n, but can it be shown for all values of delta? That would be great. We'll skip the last open question. There are many, many open questions here. And the commercial before I finish is that I've just written a monograph with Leonid Barenboim on this subject, and it can be found, a preliminary draft of it can be found on my webpage. And also I'm looking for grad students or postdocs to work on this exciting stuff. So, okay, thank you, and I will be happy to take questions. No, not randomly. You look on the neighborhood of this vertex, and there is necessarily a color used by at most delta over p neighbors of it, because you are using p colors only. You recolor in this color, and you do it repetitively, and after at most capital A iterations, you will end up, there is a very simple argument, you will end up with a delta over p defective